Here are the pillars of the porch of King Solomon's temple. King Solomon did not simply erect them as ornaments to the temple, but memorials of God's repeated promises of support to his people of Israel. Boaz, the name of the left pillar, means in strength. The right pillar, Jacob, means God will establish, which signifies when combined the message, in strength, God will establish his house in Israel. And thus were the Jews, in passing through the porch to the temple, daily reminded of the abundant promises of God, and inspired with confidence in his protection and gratitude for his many acts of kindness to his holy, to his chosen people. The globes on the left represents earth, that on the right, heaven. The outer pillars of the porch are called the pillars of Enoch. Enoch, fearing that the principles of the arts and sciences might be lost, erected two pillars, one of marble to resist fire, the other of brass to resist water. On each, he engraved all the knowledge which he feared would be lost. The globes represent unity, peace, and plenty. These pillars also support the rainbow, which is sometimes associated with the Holy Royal Arch. It is called the Arch of Heaven and is symbolic of the architectural arch. The mosaic pavement is a representation of the ground floor of King Solomon's temple. The mosaic pavement is emblematical of human life, checked with good and evil. The blazing star reminds us of that awe-inspiring period when the Almighty delivered the two tablets on stone containing the Ten Commandments to his faithful servant Moses on Mount Sinai. When the rays of his divine glory shone so bright that none could behold him without fear and trembling. It also represents the sacred name of God as a universal spirit who enlivens our hearts, who purifies our reason, who increases our knowledge, and makes us wiser and better men. The ark is emblematical of that divine ark, which safely carries us over this tempest-tossed life. It is sometimes shown with the anchor, an emblem of a well-grounded hope and a well-spent life. With hope, the anchor holds the soul sure and steadfast. The square within bounds is a symbol formed by four stonemason squares of equal arms superimposed one on the other to form a central cube. The square and cube are both significant symbols. The square is an emblem of morality, or the strict performance of every duty. The square teaches us to regulate our conduct before God and man. The 47th problem of Euclid's first book of geometry contained a mathematical theorem so complex that when Pythagoras solved the problem, he exclaimed, "Eureka," which signifies, "I have found it." It has been adopted as the symbol of a past master. It teaches Masons to be general lovers of the arts and sciences. The working tools of an entered apprentice Mason are the 24-inch gauge and common gavel. The 24-inch gauge is an instrument made use of by operative Masons to measure and lay out their work. But we, as brain-accepted Masons, are taught to use it for the more noble and glorious purpose of dividing our time. It being divided into 24 equal parts is emblematical of the 24 hours of the day, which we are taught to divide into three equal parts, whereby are found 8 hours for the service of God and a distressed worthy brother, 8 for our usual vocations, and 8 for refreshment and sleep. The common gavel is an instrument made use of by operative Masons to break off the corners of rough stones, the better to fit them to the builder's use. But we, as free and accepted Masons, are taught to use it for the more noble and glorious purpose of divesting our hearts and consciences of the vices and superfluities of life, thereby fitting our minds as living stones for that spiritual building, that house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The plumb is an instrument made use of by operative Masons to try perpendiculars, the square to square their work, and the level to prove horizontals. But we, as free and accepted Masons, are taught to use them for more noble and glorious purposes. The plum admonishes us to walk uprightly in our several stations before God and man, squaring our actions by the square of virtue, ever remembering that we are traveling upon the level of time towards that undiscovered country from whose bourn no traveler returns. The trowel is an instrument made use of by operative masons to spread the cement which unites the building into one common mass. But we, as free and accepted masons, are taught to use it for the more noble and glorious purpose of spreading the cement of brotherly love and affection. That cement which unites us into one sacred band or society of friends and brothers, among whom no contention should ever exist, but that noble contention, or rather emulation, of who best can work and best agree. The setting maul in operative masonry is used for setting stones, that is, by tapping them to a firm seat in the mortar, by urging them sideways into place. It is considered by some to be a symbol of untimely death. The coffin containing the remains of a deceased friend and brother reminds the Masons that we are in charge, that we are the custodians of a great heritage passed along to us in the story of the Hiramic legend. The sprig of acacia is a symbol of the immortality of the soul. Like the flower which cometh forth and is cut down, reminds us of the transitory nature of human life. The beehive is an emblem of industry. It teaches Masons that we came into this world rational and intelligent beings. So should we be, industrious ones. The sword, pointing to a naked heart, demonstrates that sooner or later, justice will overtake us, and that although our thoughts, words, and actions may be hidden from the eyes of man, they are not hidden to the all-seeing eye. The tassel consists of a cord with tassels on end. It represents the mystic tie, that bond which unites men of diverse opinions into one sacred band of friends and brothers. In closing, the ceremonies and lectures in symbolic masonry beautifully illustrate this all-engrossing subject, and the conclusion that we arrive at is that youth, properly directed, leads us to honorable and virtuous maturity, and that the life of man, regulated by morality, faith, and justice, will be rewarded at its final hour by the prospect of eternal bliss. And he who hears from his master the approving language, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joys of thy Lord." Thank you.